kept in. Corcoran with the shot, and it's in.
He may get him on the inside. Willie's got him. Willie hit it.
TV3 Sports has come to Doc Gelt's Field in Verona for the semifinal round of the 59th annual Greater Newark Tournament. This afternoon, the Glen Ridge Ridgers take on the Lancers of Livingston High School. Hello again, everybody. I'm Matt Lachlan, along with me, Bill Bromberg. And Bill, this is similar in some ways to the first semifinal game in which we had a seeded team going up against the team that was a bit of a surprise. That's Cedar Grove against Eastside. Here we have a seeded team, Glen Ridge, seventh, going up against the real surprise of this tournament, the Livingston Lancers.
Livingston came out of nowhere. In fact, they didn't even qualify for the state tournament. They were under 500 at the cutoff. But since then, they've gotten red hot, and it's carried right through the GNT.
A lot of changes they made in the early game. They had problems defensively. They made three changes in the infield. The first baseman was the only guy who stayed around. And it's a young team, a young infield particularly, but once they solidified that, things fell into place. They've won 14 of their last 21.
And that's when it counts. And Livingston has a habit of doing this. They made a run in the GNT a couple of years ago. In fact, in the last few years, Livingston is almost a write-in to get here on this particular Saturday.
Livingston has a leadoff hitter that, well, once he gets on, he's virtually guaranteed of having another base.
Garrett Newbard is their center fielder, leads off. He's tried 28 steals this year, and he has been successful all 28 times. You can pitch out on him, and it has made no difference. And Matt, he's almost got 40 runs scored. That's unbelievable for a high school athlete.
It is tremendous, and the numbers are quite impressive. We talked about Glen Ridge. We talked about the fact that they are the seventh-seeded team. They are the team of the 80s. They were in this final six times. They're hoping to get a streak in the 90s going and get to next Saturday's championship. How they do today may depend on how well their backstop, Jeff Giambrone, does.
And if you were with us earlier in the week, we saw Giambrone out in left field. Well, today he's back where he belongs, behind the plate. He leads Glen Ridge in almost all their offensive categories. Plus, he's a very strong catcher. He will bat fourth in today's lineup. It should be a great game.
Jim Bowden on the mound for Glen Ridge. Josh Masler on the mound for the Livingston Lancers. That sets the scene. We'll be back with the opening pitch right after this. A warm day for baseball, hazy, hot, and humid. You would think it was the end of July rather than the end of May. But summer has arrived early here in North Jersey, and we are about ready for the start of this semifinal matchup between Livingston and Glen Ridge. Livingston won the toss before the game. They are the home team. Here's the batting order for the visitors from Glen Ridge under head coach Tim Byron. Bart Ciccolini leads things off. He's the third baseman. Batting second is Dan Rizzo, the right fielder. He'll be followed by Chris Diamond, the second baseman. Batting in the cleanup position is Jeff Giambrone, the catcher. In the fifth spot, Tom King, the shortstop. He'll be followed by Mike Boyette, the left fielder. Batting seventh is Pete Ostella, the first baseman. In the eighth hole, Sam Delaney, the center fielder. And batting ninth, the designated hitter, Tyler Hodgson. He will be batting for the pitcher, Jim Bowden. Down at first base for the Lancers, that's John Sorrentino. He is the only senior member of the infield. The second baseman is a sophomore, Brian Meyerhofer. The shortstop is also a sophomore, David Malucci. And down at third base, junior, Jerry Poto. The left fielder is a sophomore, Eric Rothfeld. Around in center field is Garrett Newbart. And the right fielder is John Conforti. Behind the plate this afternoon for the Lancers, Bobby Pillis. And on the mound, right-hander, a senior, Josh Massler. Massler will go with off-speed stuff all day. He's 3-2, 3.43 earned run average. He has pitched 47 innings. He has struck out 42. He has walked just 9. Those are power pitcher numbers. But he goes with off-speed, goes with junk, keeps the batters off balance. And he does have excellent control.
And Tim Byron was telling his players before the game, move up in the box. He will not overpower you.
The umpiring crew today, as we take a look at the head coach at Glen Ridge, Tim Byron. Rich DeSimone behind the plate, calling balls and strikes. On the first base side, Paul DeCencio. And on the third base side will be Hank Cordero. Rich on the left, Hank in the middle, and Paul on the right. We're about ready to begin action. The winner advances to Saturday's championship game, which will be here at 2 o'clock. They will take on Cedar Grove. The Panthers won the first game by a score of 6-1 over Eastside High School. Glen Ridge made 6 appearances in the GNT championship in the 1980s. They won 2 crowns during that decade. They're looking to get to the final in 1991. Bart Ciccolini leads things off, a 3-10 hitter with 9 runs batted in. And the senior swings at the first pitch and fouls it back. Ciccolini with 1 double. Basically a singles hitter. Fastball back to the mound. Massler has plenty of time. And there's 1 down.
And in a big game like the GNT semifinals, it's always good to get that first out under your belt.
Right fielder number 33, Dan Rizzo.
Tim Byron in his first year as head coach at Glen Ridge following a 3-year stint at Ramapo. Pitched in the championship game of the GNT back in 1979. In that game, Our Lady of the Valley lost to Columbia by a score of 3-2. Dan Rizzo is the right fielder. He's batting 297 with 6 runs batted in. He's in a hole 0-1. Just missing with the fastball. On deck, Chris Diamond. Tim's brother, Vinny, down in the first base coaching box. Breaking pitch misses. It's 2-1. In fact, they don't have a uniform at Glen Ridge big enough for Vin Byron, and he's wearing his old Our Lady of the Valley uniform down at first base.
Like God, it was the same color.
Sorrentino wide of first. Nice play by Massler covering. And the speedy Rizzo getting quickly out of the box is retired. The left-handed hitter has the advantage on a play like that, but good sound defense by the Lancers.
This looks very easy, but it's a play you have to practice continually. Chopper on the first base side. Watch the pitcher Massler immediately break to the bag, and that's what he's trained to do. And then it becomes just quickly Sorrentino to Massler. It looks so easy, but boy, it's very easy to make a mistake on that play.
In the Cedar Grove game, we saw a mistake made by Eastside's pitcher Sandy Lopez, and it wound up costing him in a big 5-run fifth inning. Breaking pitch falls in there to Chris Diamond. Diamond, a senior, playing second base. Batting 268 with 17 runs batted in. Off the screen, it's 0-2.
Massler's not doing anything fancy except throw strikes. And that's the name of the game.
A lot of room back here behind home plate. We have talked about it every time we come to Doc Gelt's field. You've got to be a good catcher. Popped it up. Might be a play. Pillis coming back, but it's in the crowd. Vinny Byron has experience in the GNT, Bill. In 1973, he pitched all 4 games that Valley won en route to their championship. And in that championship game, he pitched his club to a 3-1 victory over Bloomfield.
He's loosening up the arm, Matt. He sees the GNT. He's ready to go.
A lot of GNT experience on the coaching lines for both teams. We'll talk about that when Livingston comes to bat. Fastball to right field. Should be an easy play for Conforti, and it is. So an easy 1-2-3 inning for Josh Masler and the Livingston Lancers. And we'll go to the bottom half of the first inning with Glenridge out rather easily. Beautiful day for baseball. Little warm, but a breeze blowing.
And there is a threat of an afternoon thunderstorm later on, Matt.
And you see some clouds in the distance, but they are rather in the distance. John Schmidt is the first-year head coach of the Livingston Lancers, and this is the batting order that he'll send up against Jim Bowden. Garrett Newbart, the center fielder, leads things off. He's followed by Brian Meyerhofer, the second baseman. Batting in the three spot is John Sorrentino, the first baseman. John Conforti, the right fielder, bats cleanup. He'll be followed by Andy Sonnenberg, the designated hitter. Eric Rothfeld, the left fielder, will follow Sonnenberg. Batting in the seventh spot is Jerry Poto, the third baseman. Bobby Pillis, the catcher, will bat eighth. And batting ninth, shortstop David Malucci. Down at first base, that's Pete Ostella. At second, Chris Diamond. Around at shortstop for the Ridgers, Tom King. And down at the hot corner, Bart Ciccolini. In left field, that's Mike Boyette. The center fielder is Sam Delaney. And around in right field, Dan Rizzo. Behind the plate, junior Jeff Giambrone. And on the mound, Jim Bowden. Bowden 6-2 on the year. 2.55 earned run average. Has struck out 57 batters in 54 and two-thirds innings pitched.
The big number there is the 39 walks. Bowden must throw strikes.
There's some pressure on any team that is seeded, Bill. There is virtually little pressure on a club that comes out of nowhere. And that's exactly what Livingston has done. They started out 1-6, made some changes, and they've gone on a tear ever since. There's John Schmidt, the head coach. In his first year, he was 14 years as either the JV or the freshman coach at Livingston. Now an opportunity with the varsity. Down the first base side is Scott Parsons, and Parsons, a familiar name, one of the all-time greats from Livingston High School, graduated in 1980. Livingston won the GNT championship that year by a score of 8-6 over Belleville. The year before, in 79, they were in the final. They lost to Columbia 5-4. So there is that GNT experience. The Byrons have pitched in GNT championship games. Parsons has played in them.
Did Timmy and Scott Parsons play against each other?
Well, Timmy graduated in 79, so they are contemporaries.
Yeah. I wonder if they ever pitched against each other. I wonder what stories they might have to tell.
Parsons played for a year with the University of Miami, then was signed by the San Diego Padres, stayed in that organization for 8 years. He's in his first year working with the Livingston Lancers, and before the game he was telling me he's having a great time with it.
I remember watching him play. Kind of dates us, and hard to believe that much time has gone by.
Garrett Newbart will step in to lead things off, batting .426 with 18 runs batted in. And as we mentioned in our open, 28 stolen bases. Has scored 38 runs, 7 doubles, 3 triples to go along with his one home run. He's got 18 runs batted in.
He'll be looking for a walk, which could become a double.
That's the way it has worked for Livingston. Combine his 32 hits and 75 at-bats. He had 18 walks to that total. He's on base an awful lot.
Two-thirds of the time, practically.
28 for 28 in stolen bases. Will attend Columbia next year.
Yeah, hopes to play some baseball there.
In the EIBL. The Ivy League teams are in the Eastern Intercollegiate Baseball League, along with Army and Navy, I believe, are the other two clubs. The winner gets an automatic bid to the NCAA. This year it was Princeton which won. They were eliminated promptly, though, losing 2 games in the tournament. On deck, Brian Meyerhofer. Fouled over our heads and out of play. Count 1-2 to Newbart. Meyerhofer to follow, then John Sorrentino. A still day. There is a flag in front of the scoreboard out in right field, and it is moving very, very little. Ooh. Check swing, fouled back into the stands. The fans scramble, nobody hurt. And that was kind of a protection move by Garrett Newbard. Had to get out of the way of the inside pitch, was able to foul it off. Now, of course, the flag moves a little bit as we get a shot of it, but you can see it's hanging rather limp. It is a very still afternoon. Outfield pretty much straight away, not too deep. Swung on and missed. Newbart goes down swinging. 10th time he has struck out this year. First strikeout of the ball game for Jim Bowden.
Well, it was a 3-2 pitch, just a good hard fastball. As we said, you don't want to walk Newbart, and just got it past him. This is a Livingston team, Matt. We'll go over the stats later. That most of the starters have more walks than they have strikeouts.
Here's Brian Meyerhofer, the sophomore second baseman. Meyerhofer batting 333. Started the year on the JV, but he was one of the many changes made in the infield after seven games. The problem was they were just kicking the ball around too much, making too many errors, and on any level, you can't give the opposition extra chances. Meyerhofer has drawn 18 walks to go along with 25 base hits. Key stat, he struck out just six times.
Yep. He's got a 3-1 strikeout to walk ratio in favor of the walks. Team takes pitches, will make the pitcher work.
And when you have someone like Newbart leading things off, and he's got the speed he has to move into scoring position after a walk or a base hit, when you think about it, a sophomore who didn't start the year on the varsity in the number two spot shows you the confidence John Schmidt has in this young man. There's a call strike. It's 2-1. Obviously, Meyerhofer not overwhelmed at all by the situation. He'll be around for two more years.
You can see already the pattern here. Livingston went down very quickly. 1-2-3, swinging a lot of first pitches. Glenn Ridge. And now Livingston is just taking pitches. The first batter went 3-2. It's now 3-1. They're going to make Bowden work on this hot day.
In the first semifinal, Ron Ulrich. We didn't know if he would be able to make it as a walk is drawn by Meyerhofer. If he would be able to make it through seven innings, he was wild early, and with the heat, we thought that perhaps he would not be able to complete the game, but to his credit, he was able to throw a lot of pitches and still complete it.
First baseman, number 22, John Sorrentino.
One down and one on for John Sorrentino. Sorrentino batting 325 with 17 runs batted in, four doubles and a triple. Batted over 400 last year. Dropped off just a little bit in his senior year. Pops it foul down the third baseline. Ciccolini almost comes up with the fine play. But it's a foul ball. 0-1 to Sorrentino. Sorrentino headed to Rutgers next year.
Hopes to play a little baseball. Crowd gives Ciccolini a nice hand for this effort, and it's an excellent effort. Just missed it.
Tough play, running backwards over the shoulder. Count 0-1 to the lefty swinging Sorrentino. The only lefty hitter in the lineup. Meyerhofer with the short lead. 1-1. Meyerhofer has stolen 12 bases. That's third on the team. Newbart with 28, Conforti with 17. One and two. Nice crowd on hand when you take into consideration that it is the Memorial Day weekend and a lot of people taking advantage of the 3-day weekend and heading to Point South, but a nice crowd.
Would you rather be here or
sitting on the Garden State Parkway in bumper-to-bumper traffic.
I thought you were going to say sitting on the beach, and I'd say that's a toss-up. That's a toss-up, but I'd much prefer to be here than on the parkway. The runner goes as Sorrentino swings through it. Good throw down by GM Rohn. And it's a strike him out, throw him out for Glenn Ridge. Two strikeouts in the inning for Bowden. No runs, no hits, no errors, a walk, one left, and a beautiful strike him out, throw him out. GM Brohn throwing out Meyerhofer to end the first inning. We'll take a short break. We'll come back with more right after this.
Roundtable, the sports talk show that you, the viewer, can contribute to. Join the TV3 sports team as they discuss the latest events making news in the world of sports. Whether it's the high school, college, or professional ranks, the TV3 sports team is prepared to talk about it. You can get involved by calling 636-5333 and become part of the discussion. The Roundtable, live every Monday night at 7:30 p.m., only on Suburban Cablevision TV3.
A shot from center field of Doc Gelt's field. Quick quiz question. What's the first name of Doc Gelt?
I don't want to give it away.
Well, who else is? Paul. Paul Doc Gelt's field. We have to thank the athletic director, Rich Meyer, and his staff here at Verona High School, along with the Big E.
Not so big anymore.
No.
Eric Mortensen.
The recreation director at Verona. He had his crew out working on the game. On the field, taking care of things. Putting the bunting up around. And making things look rather nice for the semifinal round.
Vinny Byron and Scott Parsons exchanging pleasantries as they go to the coach. Actually exchanging pushes is what happened.
Good natured, though.
Oh, yeah.
A couple of big guys.
Ooh.
Tony Hope is sitting nearby as he's the Livingston Athletic Director. Overheard us talking earlier about whether or not Parsons and Byron would have faced each other. The year that Valley was defeated by Columbia in 1979, Valley knocked out Livingston in the semifinals. So there was the matchup. Jeff GM Brohn leads things off here in the top half of the second inning. GM Brohn hitting cleanup in the order. We saw his numbers 444. Three homers, 21 runs batted in. Tied for team honors in the RBI category with Mike Boyette.
We also saw his arms end that bottom of the first inning.
Very impressive.
Mm-hmm.
Just a junior, way out in front. And the count is 1-1. GM Brohn, Tom King, Mike Boyette in the second inning.
This is just a very off-speed breaking pitch, and GM Brohn just well out in front of it.
Fouled over our head and out of play. The count is 1-2. We must not have paid homage at one point to the baseball gods, because there have been a number of foul balls that have headed our way. Of course, one in the first game nearly decapitated my partner. Hard hit ball to right center field, but on the move, Garrett Newbart. A lot of speed as he chases the ball down in the gap. Ball stayed up a little bit for him, but he used his burners to track it down.
Well, we talked about Garrett's speed offensively, and now you see it defensively. GM Brohn gets all of this one. And when it leaves the bat, you're looking at a gapper and maybe two or three bases. Newbart just eats up the territory and makes it look routine.
Ball looked like trouble off the bat of GM Brohn, but Newbart doing it up defensively in center field. And there's one down here in the top half of the second inning. Tom King will step in, the junior shortstop, batting 333, 16 runs batted in. Two homers, another extra base hit, that being a triple. Bit of a welcomed breeze blowing up now. cooling things down just momentarily, though. Ripped foul as King was waiting on the off-speed pitch. Glenridge won yesterday afternoon in the state playoffs, defeating sectional champion and 1990 Group 1 runner-up New Providence by a score of 6-5. Popped up. Malucci calling for it at shortstop. Backtracks a little bit into the short of the outfield grass, and there's two down.
The ball was high enough to bring some rain, and
major league pop up.
Malucci just literally surrounded the ball.
Two down here in the top of the second, and Mike Boyette steps to the plate. Has a bit of an injured wrist, and there was some question as to whether or not he would bat, but here he is. Grounder deep in the hole. Tough play for Malucci. Has to double clutch as he has a little trouble getting the ball out of his glove. And an infield hit for Boyette. And that's the kind of base hit, Bill, that if he does have a sore wrist, if it's bothering him much, it'll bother him more after this one.
Sure will. Right off the end of the bat. Deep in the hole. Malucci, you'll watch him skid a little bit on the dirt right there. And now smartly decides he doesn't have a throw. The only thing he could have done there is thrown it away.
Runner on with two down for Pete Ostella. Boyette not a real threat to steal. 8 stolen bases. Glenridge with that victory yesterday advances to the sectional semifinals on Tuesday. They will take on Butler, which knocked off number 1 seeded Brearley yesterday by a score of 5-4. It was a come-from-behind effort yesterday for the Ridgers, and New Providence had their ace Ernie Schmidt on the mound. And as they were rallying in the seventh inning, Paul Miller went out to talk to his ace right-hander with the bases loaded and a tie ball game, and he barely had time to get back to the dugout and take a seat because on the very first pitch, Schmidt hit a batter
boink
to force in the winning run.
We're talking about that. A lot of people were at that game were telling us about it before. That must have been quite a game. At one point, I think New Providence led 5-2. Speaking about getting hit by pitch.
Ostella gets poinked in the back. Off-speed pitch. Won't hurt him that much, but it will put runners at first and second.
Yeah, if you got to get hit, this is the kind of pitch. It's not too bad. Just turn the back, take it right on the 3, and I'll take the base.
So 2 on and 2 down. Sam Delaney, the sophomore center fielder, coming to the plate, batting 302 this season. Delaney, the only sophomore on the roster. There are 2 freshmen that have been brought up recently. Junior senior club for Glenridge. Grounder in the hole. Malucci gets a nice hop, flips to second, but not in time. And now Boyette tries to come home. The throw home, not in time. Aggressive base running by Boyette. Timmy Byron also very alert in the third base box. And you also have to credit Ostella with getting down to second quickly. It was a slow hit ball. Malucci had a hurry and couldn't make the play at second.
He was covering to keep the runner close. Now the ball is hit back in the hole. He's got to come all the way over, slides a little bit. And the throw there is late. And give Ostella credit for getting there quickly. Now here comes Boyette around third. Good throw, might have had him, but it takes the tough hop. Boyette is in with the first run of the game.
So a 1-0 lead for the Ridgers, and Tyler Hodgson comes to the plate. He is the designated hitter today, batting for the pitcher Jim Bowden.
Delaney should get credit, by the way, for an infield single on the play that went to second. Everybody just out-hustled the ball.
Down at second base, Pete Ostella. His hustle created the run. As he was able to beat the throw to second, that would have been the third out. down at first base, Sam Delaney. Oh, and two, the count to Tyler Hodgson. Two infield hits and a hit batsman in this inning. And Glenn Ridge on the board.
Hardest hit ball was the fly ball that Newbert tracked down in center.
Yeah, off the bat of GM Brown. Mm-hmm. On deck, Bart Ciccolini. The winner moves on to the championship game on Saturday. And there'll be a big crowd here for that. Always draws well. 2 o'clock start at Doc Geltz Field. We'll be here to bring you the championship round action. Cedar Grove against the winner of this game. 0-2 delivery. 1-2. Massler started out easy, though GM Brones was a hard hit ball. It was caught by Newbart, and then Tom King was retired on a pop too short. Since then, he's run into a little trouble, but some of it's been his own doing with the hit batsman sandwiched around two infield singles. 2-2. Count draws even. Massler had him 0-2. Took a little something off it, and Hodgson goes down swinging. First strikeout in the ball game for Massler. In the inning, Glenn Ridge, though, gets on the board. They score a run on two hits, no errors, and two left on after an inning and a half. It's Glenn Ridge 1, Livingston nothing.
Suburban Cablevision TV 3 is proud to announce that Suburban High School Sports Report with Rob Mottola has been honored with an ACE Award in the category of program series about sports. So if you need to know who's hot and who's not in scholastic sports, catch the Suburban High School Sports Report Thursdays at 7 p.m. and Fridays at 8 p.m. only on Suburban Cablevision TV 3.
Fans enjoying this afternoon's action from Doc Geltz Field. Glenn Ridge, the second Colonial Hills Conference team that made it to the semifinals. One of them, Cedar Grove, has already advanced to the championship. It's been a good year for the CHC.
Did you find the Colonial Hills yet? We got the map
still
out.
Still looking for the Colonial Hills, but the Colonial Hills Conference doing very well this year. Chatham won the CHC this year, and they're having a year that they haven't had it in Chatham for ages. Not known as a baseball school, but this year they're having a very fine year. They won the conference. They had the number one seed in North 2, Group 2. They defeated Rahway in the quarterfinal round. They'll take on Dayton in the semifinal round in a game that has to be played by Tuesday. And, of course, Glen Ridge and Cedar Grove still alive. We go to the bottom half of the second inning. John Conforti, Andy Sonnenberg, and Eric Rothfeld to face Jim Bowden. Glenn Ridge with a 1-0 lead. Foul down the first base side. We mentioned that there was a coin flip before the game to determine who the home team was. We won't mention which club this happened to, but last week a coach sent out one of his players to take a coin flip. The team won the coin flip, but the player wanted to be the away club. And so he gave up home advantage, last at-bats. And the coach, needless to say, will not make that mistake again.
Ooh.
That's kind of like saying in overtime, well, we won the flip, but we'll kick it to you.
Nobody to blame but yourself.
Yeah. Well, Jerry Markbright, the NFL referee, tells a story on how he screwed up his first Super Bowl on a coin flip. Apparently, the coin was such that you didn't really, there was no clear heads or tails. He had designated it beforehand to both captains, but when he flipped it, he was so nervous, he wasn't sure which side landed. Was that the tails or the head side? Some of the Livingston fans questioning this call.
Okay.
Maybe good reason. Looked like it was a little outside and low. Richie DeSimone behind home plate. Usually a good balls and strikes man. Paul DeCenzio down to first base side. Hank Cordero at third. Count 2-2 now to John Conforti.
When I was coaching, I was hiring my own umpires, and the first umpire I call each year was Rich DeSimone.
Down to third. Charity hop for Ciccolini as he handles it easily. Wall took a nice, high, long hop to him, and there's one down. Andy Sonnenberg is the DH today. He is a senior. He is batting for Massler. He's having a good year. 381 with 13 runs batted in. Sonnenberg started the year at third base, had some problems defensively, but John Schmidt didn't want to lose his bat, so converted him to the DH role. And to his credit, yeah, it's tough for a senior. You want to play both offensively and defensively. New head coach comes in. I mean, you could see some seniors just packing it in.
Yeah.
Coach, if I can't play, I don't want. I'll give you my uniform.
You know,
back.
The team got off, as you said earlier, Matt, 1-6. New coach. Maybe you give the seniors a first shot before you want to make too many waves.
Mm-hmm.
And to their credit, John Schmidt made the changes. The team responded very positively to them.
Well, Sonnenberg hasn't let it affect him, as we mentioned. He's batting 381, 7 doubles, 2 triples to go along with his home run. 21 for 55 on the year. The count 2-1 here. Foul tipped. Count goes to 2-2.
Of course, Bill Lampeter and Luke Calderon, the longtime coaches at these two schools. I guess between the two of them, they must have had 40 years experience, by 20 each or close to it.
Lost a lot of coaches who had coached for a long time at the end of last year. Bobby Schnaufer at West Essex.
Yep.
Jimmy Castellino, who wasn't a longtime coach at Irvington, but had coached at a lot of places. Mm-hmm. Moving on to Union County College. There's a call, strike three. Sonnenberg doesn't like the call, but it's the third strikeout for Bowden.
And as long as Bowden throws strikes, Livingston would like to take pitches and walks. They're going to have to start swinging the bat. That's just right down the pike.
Yeah. Sonnenberg looking back, but no reason to. That was right down the chute. Two down for Eric Rothfeld, the sophomore left fielder. In addition to his left field duties, Rothfeld has also pitched this year, batting 276, 17 runs batted in. One and one. On deck, Jerry Poto. 1-0 Glenridge on top. They scored in their half of the second inning. We're in the bottom half of the second. Sunny, still afternoon. Hard hit ball to center field. Delaney giving chase. He won't be able to catch up with it. Skips past him. At least two for Rothfeld. Rothfeld looking for three. He'll make it easily as the ball is relayed. Diamonds throw. Not nearly in time, a stand-up triple for Eric Rothfeld, his first triple of the season.
And he got all of this one. Delaney gave it a shot, but the ball was curving away from him towards right field. Here's the triple by Rothfeld. Bang. Delaney immediately gave chase. The ball's hooking away, and when it hits the ground, then bounces left. Watch. It's bouncing toward right. Whoops! Now bounces back toward center field, and Delaney had to make a U-turn. Rothfeld hustling all the way, could see the ball in front of him, and he gets the third.
Opportunity here for the Lances, but there are two away. Jerry Poto, the third baseman, at the plate. Poto batting 314. An outstanding defensive player, but he's doing okay with the bat. 6 runs batted in. two extra base hits. You can't underestimate the value of strong defense. We and others are guilty of always talking about offensive numbers or pitching numbers. He's 6-1, he's 7-1, he's batting .340. We don't often mention defense, but if you don't have it, those other numbers don't matter much. Might drop in the gap, big gap out there in left center field, and it will. Delaney will chase it down. Livingston has tied things up. On its second base, Jerry Poto with a double.
What'd you say about double? What'd you say about his extra base hit?
Third double of the year. Those are his only extra base hits, but a timely double here.
Gets around on the inside pitch, and there is a big gap in left center field. Scoring easily was Rothfeld, and the question was, could Poto stretch this into a triple? But Delaney tracked it down quickly, had a little trouble playing it back in, but once he did, Poto was on at second base.
You know, Matt, in the top of this inning, the first two Ridgers went out, and they rallied for a run. Now in the bottom of the inning, the first two Lancers go out, and they've at least gotten one.
Two out rallies kill you.
Ooh,
as a coach.
Ooh.
Seventh run batted in, by the way, for Poto this year. Here's Bobby Pillis. Pillis, the catcher, batting just .205, but in his last 14 ball games, hitting .333.
Yeah, John Schmidt was telling me the other night that he came out of nowhere to get to .205. And he told Bobby yesterday, he finally got above the Mendoza line, and Bobby said, who's Mendoza?
Mario Mendoza, whose career batting average was somewhere around .200. Not much above it.
Back to the mound, through the hole. Nice play by King, staying with it because the ball skipped over the bag, but he was able to stay with it and make the play. Pillis retired on the grounder, but in the inning, Livingston ties things up. A triple by Eric Rothfeld, followed by a double by Jerry Poto. And at the end of two innings of play, it's Glen Ridge 1, Livingston 1.
Hi, I'm Merlin Olsen of the Children's Miracle Network, and I'm here with Molly Barber and our friend Mickey Mouse, who is about to unveil a most effective piece of medical equipment, a device with the ability to save the lives of thousands of children.
Please put yours to good use by calling in your pledge during the Children's Miracle Network telethon, live from Disneyland, to benefit children at Children's Specialized Hospital and Children's Hospital of New Jersey, right here on Suburban Cable Vision TV3, June 1st and 2nd.
Back at Doc Gelt's Field, Matt Laughlin along with Bill Bromberg. A number of interested spectators here. We mentioned Tony Hope, the athletic director at Livingston, sitting nearby.
Isn't he supposed to be on the field?
No more. Lou Calderon stepping down as the head coach. He's the gentleman with the aqua shirt on, wearing the glasses, sitting next to his better half, his wife Linda. His daughter, Wheezy, played for Whippany Park, because their season came to an end when they lost to Mountain Lakes in the sectional final, snapping their long winning streak. That game took place on Thursday. We can use the present tense plays because she'll be back for two more years. But their season has come to an end. We move to the top half of the third inning, a tie ball game, 1-1 between Livingston and Glen Ridge. And to take you through the middle three, my colleague, Bill Bromberg.
Thank you, Matt. 1-1 our score. Bart Ciccolini will lead off for Glen Ridge. I bet you if he asked Lou Calderon right now what's harder, coaching or watching, he'd tell you watching.
Oh, absolutely, because it is his daughter, that's first off.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, even though as a coach you have limited impact on what is done, it's up to the players to perform, you can control strategy and you make out the lineup card.
A crowded dugout. They brought up a lot of the JV players in this small dugout.
But when you're sitting in the stands, there's nothing you can do about it.
Ciccolini grounded out to lead off the game. Pitcher to first. The present coach, Tim Byron.
First pitch from Josh Masler. Taken for ball one.
Bill, last time we saw Glenn Ridge earlier this week against Verona, we were talking about the relationship between the Fiores and the Byrons and the Shepherds. Teddy Fiore, the St. Peter's basketball coach, and the former coach at Valley, Mike Shepherd, the Seton Hall University baseball coach. After the game, I talked with Timmy and Vinny. Now, I knew that the Shepherds and the Fiores were related. I knew that Teddy's sister married Mike Shepherd. And I thought there was a relationship between the Byrons and the Fiores and the Shepherds. And it turns out that Tim and Vin's mom is also a Fiore.
High ball two, 2-1.
So there are a lot of interesting discussions that must go on at the family gathering. I mean, a lot of outstanding athletes. Shep was a great athlete at Seton Hall. Of course, his sons did so well at the prep and the university. The Byrons did so well at Our Lady of the Valley and at Seton Hall University. And despite the fact that Teddy has made his living in basketball, he was an outstanding player for Seton Hall University on the baseball diamond. In fact, he's a member of the Hall of Fame at Seton Hall University, played in the Cincinnati Reds chain. A couple of guys ahead of him, you know, Pete Rose, Tony Perez.
2-2, a lot of taking off that one, and Ciccolini was way out in front. That is the second strikeout for Masler, second in a row.
Right fielder, number 33, Dan Rizzo.
I can only imagine the discussions that go on at those family reunions.
A couple of rumors surrounding Ted Fiore right now.
Yeah, something in Saturday morning's paper about him perhaps, or not perhaps, but going down to South Carolina for an interview. The vacancy created when George Felton was let go.
Dan Rizzo grounded out. First baseman do pitcher covering.
You know, not knowing what goes on behind the scenes in South Carolina, I mean, George Felton had a very good year, won 20 games, and then you're let go. It's, you know, what do you have to do? Look at what happened to Digger Phelps. You wonder what's going on in the coaching profession. Why anyone would pursue it as a full-time career. Certainly on high school level, it's not your career. It's something you'd love to do. You get paid nominally for it.
Somebody once said, don't know who, every coach is hired to be fired.
And that's understandable, and if you don't perform, fine. Mm-hmm. But if you're out there winning games, that's what you're paid to do, and as long as you're not breaking rules along the way and causing a reputation to tarnish.
Sometimes you wonder how much the alumni have to say in matters.
I think they have an awful lot.
Yeah. 1-2 pitch to Rizzo. A little chin music, 2-2. That was literally a calling card for Masler because he's been using that fastball to set up this real slow curve. Let's see if he does it again. Yep. But he misses it outside. Full count.
So far through 2 1/3 innings, Masler has not walked a batter. And, of course, that's been his Achilles heel all year long.
Yeah. Score's tied at 1. We're in the top of the third. Payoff pitch to Rizzo. Chopper wide of second. Meyerhofer over to first, and there's two away. Good solid defense so far by the Livingston infield.
Yeah, you're reading my mind. I'm awfully impressed with the youngsters in the infield. They're having been difficult plays, but they've played a solid brand of defense behind Masler, and you have to because Masler's going to be hit.
Yep.
That time, Meyerhofer making the easy play.
Two up, two down. This is where Glenn Ridge rallied in the second inning with two out and nobody aboard, and they came up with a run. Chris Diamond fly to right. That off-speed curve, high ball one.
You know, there was a time as we saw that shot up close of Meyerhofer when a sophomore didn't look that young to me.
You're getting older.
Yes, I am.
Tipped off the, I think, the mask of umpire Rich D. Simone. He's going to check the mask and his nose, and he gives it the old okay sign.
I'm okay.
What day of the week is it, Rich? Watch it. Ooh. So you want to be an umpire, huh?
Getting a little razzing from the benches. Good nature.
2-1. I never want to officiate a game where there's no clock and I have to wear protective equipment. That's definitely not my thing. Two and two.
The good umpires, though, and I'm not saying that Paul or Hank are not good umpires. They are all good umpires, and somebody, only one can be behind the plate. But all the good umpires, and I'm sure if you ask Paul and Hank what they'd rather do, it's be behind the plate, though. Mm-hmm. You know, you do have to put on all the equipment, the shin guards, and wear the chest protector and the face mask, but that's where the action is. And all the good ones want to work behind the plate.
Two and two with two outs. Diamond came into the game batting 268. Seems funny that he's batting 268. He's a much better hitter than that. A long veteran of this Glen Ridge team.
Mm. And that family name has been around a long time in Glen Ridge.
Swung on and missed. The fastball. So Josh Masler strikes out two of the three batters in the third, retiring the side in order. At the end of two and a half innings, we're tied at 1-1.
Suburban Cablevision TV3 is proud to present the Union Memorial Day Parade. Join your host, Todd Goodman, as the town pays tribute to the memory of those servicemen who fought for our country. They'll also be paying special honor to the Persian Gulf War veterans. Don't miss this opportunity to see and hear all the sights and sounds of the Union Memorial Day Parade, Tuesday, May 28th at 8:30, Friday, May 31st at 3:30, and Saturday, June 1st at 1 p.m.
Bill Bromberg along with Matt Lachlan. We're in the GNT second semifinal. The winner of this game will go on to play Cedar Grove next week. This is Livingston and Glen Ridge, and we're tied at one in the bottom half of the third inning. Jim Bowden to the mound to warm up. It doesn't take too much to warm up today. Off of the distance, it has gotten considerably darker.
It
the
has,
weatherman has said possible rain.
And a bit of breeze blowing up, so that's always an indicator that that front's moving in. One of the interested spectators here today, Dennis Sasso, the head coach at Fairleigh Dickinson University. Boy, he was a great player and a great high school coach before he moved on to the college ranks. Played at Essex Catholic, coached at Nutley, also at Middletown South.
And Dennis, forgive me, I know Dennis very well, lost probably the most heartbreaking game in GNT final history. Had a 3-0 lead on Milburn in the last inning. And Milburn rallied to win it.
That was back, I think it was 1985.
I think Dennis has it tattooed somewhere, so we'll check it out. 9-1-2 for Livingston. It's David Malucci. David the shortstop, batting 347. First pitch is taken for a call, strike one. And you can see from your picture that the sun now is behind the clouds, which makes it more comfortable.
1984, as I look it up, is when Milburn defeated Nutley.
Dennis still teaches at Nutley. Outside, ball one, 1-1.
One of his former players, Bobby Harbison, is an assistant coach at Cedar Grove. And we will see the Panthers in the championship of the GNT next Saturday afternoon. We hope you can come out and watch the game. 2 o'clock at Doc Geltz Field. Great place to see a game. Lots of seating, good views.
And pretty good hot dogs as well.
Yes, the Verona Booster Club doing a brisk business. Good group of people. Every year they're out here working the games and they support Verona Athletics.
2 balls, 1 strike.
And periodically they stop by with a soda for us, and we are very grateful on this sticky day for the refreshments.
2-2. Bart Ciccolini's father involved over there, so he came over and said thank you for us. Here's that last pitch.
Little bit of a slider.
2-2. Right side. Diamond, he's tough over there. Over to Ostello, and there's one away.
Diamond, a stocky young man, built low to the ground. There's big Scott Parsons. I think Scott Parsons was that big when he was a sophomore, a freshman.
He was seventh grade.
Yeah, I mean, he was just, you know, physically very big and matured early. And, boy, he was a great player.
Garrett Newbart struck out. And Bowden must keep Newbart off base.
That was a golden time for Livingston Athletics. Oh. Parsons, Stan Yagello, George Albert.
Albert, mm-hmm.
Tommy Lombarski, I guess, preceded them all But he was a great player for the Lancers, too. Bowden's got the breaking pitch working.
Remember, remember Yagiela? He was maybe the best quarterback I ever saw in high school.
And went on to William and Mary.
Wasn't a real big youngster. Hard ground ball on the right side. Diamond again. Offline, and this one will go into foul ball territory. Actually, it bounces off there and goes to play at second. He is safe. There's a dead ball line, but the ball bounced off the wall and was in play.
Yeah, it bounced off the cement wall that starts the stance, came right back to GM Brone. GM Brone hustling behind the play. Of course, it's the catcher. He is running down behind the play. And you can see the wall back there where that photographer is. And we'll look at the play. GM Brone backing it up as he should on any grounder, running toward first. And he's in good position here. Diamond had to hurry his throw after he makes the nice play on the ground ball. Now it bounces right back to GM Brone. And Newbart has to hustle.
Take off.
And he just makes it in. The throw was there, but they didn't bring the tag back around to get him.
So with one out, there's a runner at second. Brian Meyerhofer walked. He calls time. Last play will be scored a hit and an error. Give Newbart the single, the infield single, and the error allows him to go to second, error on Diamond's throw.
First error of the ball game.
Meyerhofer, the number two hitter in the lineup. Newbart, of course, definite threat to steal. Play at second, not in time.
A definite threat to steal, and he's got a good stick man up in Meyerhofer.
Well, with one out, I don't know if I want my runner trying to steal third. With two outs, possibly. Shortstop King very close behind Newbart at second. Pitch is on the corner. It is getting darker and darker.
Yes, it is.
I've heard no rumbles of thunder, but there's a threat. Game is not official at this point. We're in the bottom of the third, tied at one. 1-0 pitch. Misses inside, 2-0. Count is corrected to 1-1. Scoreboard had it at 2-0, so it's now 1-1. First pitch was a strike.
If Meyerhofer can get around on Bowden and pull it to left field, he's got an easy double because Boyette has moved over to left center field. Meyerhofer now stepping down to talk to John Schmidt. Might be an indication that something might be on.
Sorrentino on deck. He's the number three batter. Meyerhofer bats 333, Sorrentino 325, and then Conforti at 423. So you've got some pretty good sticks up here for the Lancers. One on one. Bounces and knocked down very nicely by GM Brone. And as we've mentioned several times, anything past the catcher costs you base.
And GM Brone's not used to working with a backstop that's so far back. At Glen Ridge, it's just a few feet behind home plate.
The only advantage, Glen Ridge does play Verona in their conference here, so they're more used to being here, although they don't get a lot of experience. Livingston does not play here at all, obviously.
But they have a lot of room
behind
at Memorial Field,
right,
so
exactly.
They're used to the situation.
Infield pop-up out of play, back into the stands.
Head over near Elliot Lovey, the Livingston tennis coach here in attendance today.
Who tried to give it the overhand, I noticed, with that.
A lot of people out to watch today's game.
Always difficult to tell. It's such a wide complex. People are behind the trees, sitting in the shade. 2-2 pitch. Runner going. Drive to right field. This is going to be trouble. Rizzo now in foul territory. It drops, and it's ruled fair. It's ruled a fair ball. Here comes Newbart. He will score. On his way to third is Meyerhofer, and he is in with a triple. Home plate umpire Richie DeSimone calls this a fair ball.
And the Byron brothers are going to come out and argue with DeSimone as Meyerhofer is on at third. Now, the only thing that I can say, because it looked from our advantage point as if it was a foul ball. Perhaps Rizzo touched it with his glove in fair territory. The only other thing is the first baseman, Pete Ostella, was blocking the view. He was right on the line and didn't give Richie DeSimone a good view of it. We're going to take a look at it. Now, our angle won't be down the line, so it will be difficult to tell. Let's see if we can pick it up. Now, you can see Ostella starting to move toward the line. He blocks it off. This is Rizzo making a long run. Let's see, does he touch
first
it in fair territory?
John Sorrentino.
That's a fair ball. That's a good call. That's a great call by Richie DeSimone.
Wow.
The replay confirms it, and it confirms what we know about Richie. He's a good umpire.
And I thought it was foul. And Matt thought it was foul. And most of the people here thought it was foul.
Including, I think, the Livingston fans even thought it might have been foul. But the replay confirms
it. I'll tell you, we showed the replay, and about 20 people got behind us to see it. And they all, fair ball.
Yeah, no question about it.
John Sorrentino, the batter, he struck out. That's a triple and an RBI for Meyerhofer. And it's 2-1, Livingston. Sorrentino skips rope. Matt, watching Tim Byron come out to argue had to remind me of what is probably the most famous play in GNC history.
No, it was when Timmy was pitching in the 79 final, and there was a play in which there was a little squibbler hit off the mound, wide of the mound. He picked it up, went to tag the runner, and Keith Doyle, the home plate umpire, said, no, you didn't tag him. And a brouhaha ensued. Teddy Fiore was the coach at the time, and boy, he and Keith went face to face, chest to chest.
And I remember our camera was right in close, tight to them. Count is 2-0. Wind now beginning to pick up noticeably.
Mm-hmm.
You can see the trees blowing. A storm is definitely blowing in.
Yeah, it's coming our way.
It is a 2-1 game. Livingston leads in the bottom of the third. It's not official. Glenn Ridge has the infield in with one out. The pitch hits him. Hits him squarely in the back. Bowden may be a little bit upset on the play down the right field line.
Nobody to fault. I mean, Rizzo had a long way to go. He just couldn't catch up to it.
When you see your coach come out and argue, sometimes it can upset you. I wouldn't be surprised. And yeah, here comes Vinny Byron out to settle him down. So now there's runners on first and third with one out. And that's what Vinny's teaching him, not only strategy here, but this is a, let's settle down, guys. It's only a one-run game in the third inning.
In terms of strategy, I'm sure he's talking about a possible delay steal of second. What are we going to do? Are we going to throw through? Are we going to let him take second? Are we going to take a quick look at third, then throw down? A couple of things to discuss. Now, GM Brown's got a great arm, so he can get the ball down quickly. And they may elect early on here to get the out and see what happens. In the Carteret-North Plainfield game, we saw the delay steal work for Carteret. And afterwards, Steve Nelson, the veteran head coach, was telling us that the reason he employs it is because he feels it takes two on-the-money throws in order to get the runner coming down the line from third. It's got to be a good throw from the catcher down to second base, and then either the second baseman or the shortstop, who's ever covering, has got to come up with a good throw home in order to get him. And he feels that most times on the high school level, it will not happen. Let's see what Livingston decides to do.
And 40 grounded out third to first. Infield is deeper.
Looking to turn two and get out of the inning, trailing 2-1.
Call strike with the threat of rain, although it's not imminent, but we should mention it. If this game should be halted by rain, regular high school rules prevail. If it's rained out before the fifth, we're going to start all over again. If the game is official, it goes in the books just the way it finished. There's no suspension here, and then come back and finish it tomorrow.
We just got that word from Jack Venezia, the tournament director,
along with George Sanfini.
Mm-hmm. I saw George earlier today. Looking good.
Yeah.
Former Belleville head coach. Good baseball man.
Out of the stretch. Conforti showing bunt. Chances are when you show bunt that early, you're not.
Hey, get
low.
Down at third, that's Meyerhofer. Sorrentino, who was hit by the pitches at first. Go to first, Sorrentino's back. Now, at one point, are we going to fake the throw to first and wheel and throw to third? Or fake the throw to third and wheel and throw to first, Red?
Eddie Lyons told me a humorous story about that kind of play. I'll relay it in just a moment.
Sorrentino is going. The pitch is high. The throw is going through to second. The runner's coming down the line to score from third and will score. And on the delayed steal, give Brian Meyerhofer credit for a steal of home.
No thought on the part of the Ridgers to try to get the runner at home. They were looking to get the runner going down to second, hopefully pick up the second out, concede the run, and clear the bases because they didn't even attempt or give a look at home.
So it's 3-1, Lancers. Down at second is Sorrentino. Still only one out. And clearly that ball that fell down the right field line fair and was argued about has upset Jim Bowden. Sorrentino away from second. The pitch to the plate. Low in the dirt. Scooped up. Throw down to second. Sorrentino backstanding.
So anyway, Mark Lockenmeyer pitched for Princeton. And Upsala used to play Princeton. And the first time Eddie ever saw that was when Lockenmeyer attempted it. Faked the throw to first, hoped to get the guy off at third. And he never really caught anybody at Upsala with it. Anyway, Eddie's coaching up at the Cape, and he's got Lockenmeyer working for his club. And Lockenmeyer tries it. Eddie calls timeout and walks out and says, come on, Mark, this isn't the Ivy League. We got ball players out here. You're not going to catch anybody with it. Throw the darn thing. Just pitch to the batter.
I'm sure knowing Eddie, the words were a little more spicier than that.
Well, Lockenmeyer would get back at him when Eddie would be in the dugout. He'd say, boy, this guy is pitching good. Lockenmeyer would go, Eddie, it's well. He's pitching well. It's not good.
Count is 3-1. Now it's 3-1. Okay, I thought it was 2-2. I thought it was 3-1. GM Brown going to go out to the mound, talk to Bowden. Jimmy's probably out there saying, I know that ball was foul. I know it was foul. And when he sees the replay and finds out it was fair. And even if it was the worst call that ever happened in the world, you just got to shake it off and keep your mind in the game.
Yeah, it turned out to be the right call, of course. Game of inches. You hear that said so many times. And if the ball is a few more inches to the right, it's a foul ball. If the ball's a few more inches to the left, Rizzo's able to track it down and make the grab and maybe double Newbart off because Newbart was way down the line toward third.
Good point. Pitch to Conforti. And it's ball four. This inning started off with Malucci grounding out second to first, and then it was single, triple, hit batter, walk. So since the triple, Bowden has hit a batter and walked a batter. Runners on first and second, one away. Andy Sonnenberg looked at a third strike. Earlier today, Cedar Grove beat Newark Eastside 6-1. Cedar Grove will play the winner of this game. Play it second. And if it turns out to be Cedar Grove and Glen Ridge, it'll be an all-Colonial Hills final.
Mm-hmm.
Neither one of those teams being the conference champion, as Matt mentioned, Chatham the conference champion.
Chatham was the conference champion this year.
A lot of good teams in that division this year. Verona had a very nice season. Bailey Elliott had a nice season.
Top heavy, though. You know, the bottom teams are rather weak. Art, science, university.
Tip back into the glove of Jeff Giambrone.
Cedar Grove beat Glen Ridge the first time around, 3-0.
Sorrentino's at second. Conforti's at first. Conforti not being held at first.
In fact, that's the only time they played this year. They just played the once.
Mm-hmm.
But with Chatham having already clinched the crown, there's really not much sense in making up the game, especially when both teams are in the States.
That's got to be the biggest baseball conference, I think, in the state. I believe there are 14 teams
in the
conference. So it's very difficult even to play everybody twice.
Yeah, it may be that they did not, they don't schedule everybody
right,
twice.
Right, you may play some twice this year, and then the following year plays the other team.
Yeah.
1-1 on Sonnenberg. Pop foul out of play, back into the crowd. Everybody duck. We're going to get hit yet today. If you remember the game that we did earlier, Cedar Grove and Eastside, I got about as close as getting clonked as I want to get.
Yeah, that ball came right back. Hit off the table that we are using, hit off the front end of it.
I can't tell you how close it came to me because I was kissing the ground at the time.
You were out of the way quickly.
1-2. All right, 2-2. Eric Rothfeld on deck. Pop up. This would be an infield fly rule, and their batter is automatically out. Runners could advance at their own risk. Two down. And Eric Rothfeld, who tripled his first at bat. We have had two triples by Livingston in the first three innings of this game,
both by sophomores.
And Rothfeld's was a rocket. Deep to right center field.
And despite that, or rather because of it, they've swung him around far to right field. Center fielder Delaney swinging around toward right center.
Pitches low, ball one. Left fielder Mike Boyette is playing Rothfeld as a dead pull left-handed batter. You can see the gaps. Center field swung way around to right center field. Rizzo and right near the line. Two runners lead away. There are two outs. The 1-0 pitch on the right side and through into right field. Rizzo is up with it. There'll be a play to the plate coming in to score. Is Sorrentino, and as the ball gets away, here comes Conforti, and he will score. Throw back to second is into center field. Holding, though, at second base is Rothfeld, and just like that, Livingston leads 5-1.
Well, the sophomores have come to play today. We're going to take a look at it once again as Rothfeld goes opposite field with the chopper that goes through the hole. Now one run's going to score easily as Sorrentino scores. Now you see GM Brown react as the ball skips by him, and that enables Conforti to score. We almost had some more action here as Bowden sails his throw down to second, but Delaney was able to back it up as the ball sailed into center field.
Single, an RBI, and an error to allow the second run to score and for Rothfeld to get to second. Now Tim Byron goes to the mound. Four runs in for the Lancers. Bullpen action for Glen Ridge. Tyler Hodgson, I believe.
Yeah, who's the DH.
So a Tyler pitch earlier in this week. If you're wondering why they can make two visits to the mound in one inning, this is not professional ball. You can make three visits in the game. You can make them all in the same inning if you'd like. On the fourth trip to the mound, regardless of when it occurs in the game, you must remove your pitcher. So even though they made two visits, it doesn't make a difference. Jerry Poto doubled in a run his first at-bat. The Lancers have been involved in an awful lot of high-scoring games this year.
Some of the games, Matt, were like football scores.
Yeah, they beat East Orange 20-1.
They missed a conversion.
Yeah, and East Orange got the rouge.
That's right.
They came back and beat East Orange 23-8. Lost 12-7 to Roxbury. 13-8, they lost to Hanover Park.
So they have not had problems scoring runs. And they have five already today.
And recently, they really haven't had trouble keeping the opponents off the board. They lost 6-0 to Columbia in a regular season game, but you know they've given up 2 to Par Hills, 2 to Parsippany.
And the dirt rolls a little bit away from GM Brome, but Rothfeld smartly will hold it second. Livingston unseated, trying to advance into the finals. Play back to second, rolls away. Last year's finals, of course, was Seton Hall and Columbia. A lot of people thought that might be a rematch again this year, but neither one of those schools is here today. Although they're both highly seeded. 2-1 pitch. Swung on and missed, 2-2. Nutley was the number one seed. Columbia 2 and Seton Hall 3.
Yep.
Irvington was number 4, and all those teams had the day off.
Livingston knocked off Seton Hall in the first round, 5-4. And Columbia lost to Glen Ridge last weekend in the quarterfinals, 6-4.
Shows you how things change early in the season. Seton Hall played Livingston, and Seton Hall beat Livingston handily.
Yeah, 13-5.
But in the GNT, it was just the opposite.
Well, it got a little closer second time around. It was 8-5 Seton Hall won.
Sliced off the foul on the right field side foul.
Third time was a charm for the Lancers.
You've heard it said so many times, it's very difficult to beat a team twice in a season. It's even that much more difficult to beat a team a third time in a season. And third time was a charm. Bowden has been out here a long time in the bottom of the third. This will be his 68th pitch of the game. And it's lined to left field and down the line. This will score yet another run. Around first is Poto, makes the big turn and holds. That's his second RBI of the game, 8th of the season. And Livingston is enjoying a 6-1 lead. 6-1 seems to be a very good number for you and I.
Well, 6-1 in the first game. And that's where we stand right now. As you said, Bill, second RBI of the game. And boy, he got all of this one. Easily scoring was Rothfeld, and Bowden being roughed up came into the game with a 2.55 earned run average.
Bobby Pillis, the catcher, up for his second time. He bounced to short. He is the ninth man to bat for Livingston in the third inning. This started off with an out. Low ball one. 6-1 was our first game. 6-1 was the score yesterday in a game we did in the state tournament with Carteret, North Plainfield.
Mm-hmm.
We're on a roll here. I think we're going to play that number tonight.
We have to play one other.
Oh, 61.
All right.
On the corner. The sky has brightened considerably. Cloud, that big black cloud which was coming by before, is lifted. And right now it's back to the old flag hanging limp, and the air still and hot. No threat of rain at the moment. Runner at first, two outs. Runner is going. Pitch to breaking pitch low. Throw is a good one, and they got him. But for Livingston in the third inning, they come up with 5 big runs on 4 base hits. At the end of 3, the Lancers lead 6-1.
Suburban Cable and You is a live monthly talk show that allows you, the subscriber, the chance to call in and discuss any aspect of our cable system. You may be concerned with the reception or simply offer ways you think we can improve the system. Tune in and find out what's going on with your cable system, whether it's the latest technical improvements or changes on the dial. Join the management of Suburban Cablevision live on the first Monday of every month at 6:30 p.m. only on Suburban Cablevision TV3.
The Ridgers rally around Coach Tim Byron. They now trail 6-1. They once led 1-0, but there's a long way to go. We're in the top half of inning 4. So they have at least 4 more at-bats. They have been able to hit Livingston pitcher Josh Mosler so far. Livingston, though, has played extremely well defensively. Mosler on the mound, a senior right-hander, and as we've said all along, not really overpowering. But he does throw strikes, and that attests to it. A strikeout to walk ratio better than 2-1. In the top of the fourth inning, it'll be Giambrone, King, and Boyette for Glen Ridge. Mosler getting some words of encouragement from Bobby Pillis. Look, you got a 5-run lead. Just throw strikes. We'll let our defense play behind you. It's an important at-bat for the Ridgers. They want to chip away at some of this lead. Delay here. I don't know exactly why. We do have the conference at the mound, but there is no Glen Ridge batter coming to the plate. Giambrone, the catcher, is due to bat. And we're still waiting for Jeff to come out.
Leading off for Glen Ridge, the catcher, number 22.
Here comes Jeff.
Giambrone.
He was out there, Giambrone was, catching for that long half inning, and Jeff may have gotten some water or cool himself down. When you're wearing that catcher's equipment on a day like this and you're out there for as long a half inning as Giambrone was, you need a breather. So what do? They make him lead off. Jeff flied out to center field in his only appearance.
Hey, Jeff, Ray, what do you say, buddy? Start it off.
Masler's first pitch, taken, strike one. The end of the game, Matt, will say, did nothing but throw strikes.
That's all you can ask any pitcher.
That's it. Drill to center field. Newbart, thank you very much, and there's one out.
Newbart and Giambrone have played a game of catch today. Giambrone hitting the ball hard
Your
both times.
Five,
last time, Newbart had to get on his horse and take off, but this one was hit right at him. But two hard hit balls by Giambrone, and Newbart on the receiving end.
Tom King, the shortstop, popped a short. So Glen Ridge is hitting the ball hard, but Livingston is making the plays. There's a strike. In that bottom of the third inning, by the way, Livingston had 5 runs, 4 hits. There was one error. The error was the throw-in from the right fielder, which got away. 2 errors. There's a bunt down the third baseline. It's a beauty. There'll be no play at first. King saw that Poto was playing deep and just laid a beautiful bunt down the third baseline.
Well, you got to get something going. Get on however you can. Base runners have been at a premium for Glen Ridge today. Disguise it to the last moment, and no play at all for Poto.
Wisely held it.
He's got a pretty big glove down there for third baseman. It looks like, like an outfielder's glove.
I thought it was a lacrosse racket at first. There were 2 errors, actually, in the bottom of the third. One on the second baseman, which actually started the floodgates to open. And then on the throw in from right field. That was the third base hit for Glen Ridge. One on, one out. Mike Boyette has one of the hits. He had a single to deep short. Tim Byron is a very aggressive coach, and even though his team trails by 5, they may have something going.
and the sun breaks back out.
Yeah, we saw him with the tying run on base in the seventh inning against Verona with one down, send the runner. He turned out to be thrown out, and next batter made it out to end the game.
Swinging bunt on the first base side. Masler fields his position, takes the out. Moving up to second is King. Two down.
First baseman, number 23, Pete Ostella.
Pete was hit by a pitch, Pete Ostella. Batting at 273.
Bill, Glenn Ridge has to think in terms of, let's get back one at a time.
Yeah.
You know, if Ostella can come up with a base hit, it's now a 6-2 game. There's still some time, but we are in the fourth inning.
Time is called. Tim Byron was saying to us before the game, the last time he appeared on TV3, his team lost 3-2. That was as a player. In the first game he was on TV3 as a coach, his team lost 3-2. So he didn't want the score to be 3-2 today.
We got that wish.
It will not be.
He may still be looking for his first win when it's all said and done, however.
Strike one to Ostella. High foul pop-up behind the plate. And near the foul line, and it's caught in play. What a fine play by Bobby Pillis. He kept his feet inside the dead ball area. Watch it as we go out. We go to the bottom of the fourth. The Ridgers trailing the Lancers 6-1.
One out of every 100 teenagers will die in a drinking and driving accident on the night of their senior prom. Don't be a statistic.
Barry Halper here. Well, it's the bottom half of inning number four. Glen Ridge leading, trailing rather, to Livingston by a score of 6-1. And this was certainly an outstanding play to end the top half of inning number four.
Well, there's a lot of room, Bill. So first off, he's got to go track it down. Now he's got some teammates near. Now he's getting near the dugout. There are a couple of bats there. And he was able to concentrate and make the play. Really a fine play by Pillis. And we were told by John Schmidt that he is a great defensive player. And sure enough, he proves it there and as happens an awful lot. Guy who makes a good play to end an inning comes up to the plate.
You know, he looked down. You could see him look down. He looked to see where the bats were, the dead ball line was. Sized it all up. And now leads off.
While we have an opportunity, Bill, you know, we've been talking about people in the stands here today. There are two people here who are watching the game, and they have a large connection to the world of baseball. Now, their sons are playing for Livingston. Jason Halper is on the club, and so is Jeff Goldklang. Their dads are here, Marvin Goldklang and Barry Halper, and some family members. Barry and Marvin are part owners of the New York Yankees. And they recently returned from a meeting in Cleveland. Everyone was speculating what was going to go on. Just some financial matters were discussed. But they're here watching their sons play. And my guess is they get more of a thrill watching their children play than anything the Yankees could do.
Bobby Pillis bounced to short. Strike one. Absolutely.
Barry, of course, has a memorabilia collection that rivals that and in many cases surpasses that of Cooperstown. Mm-hmm. And Marvin Goldklang owns about four minor league teams in addition to owning part of the Yankees.
Slice down the right field side, hooking into foul territory and falling in front of Dan Rizzo.
If Livingston holds on to this lead, it's going to be a busy week for the Goldklangs because Ariel Goldklang plays on the softball team and they are in the Group 4 semifinals as they won the sectional championship the other day.
Saw her play in the county tournament. Ariel is the pepper pot of that team. She gets the team going. She talks from the time the game starts till it ends. Phyllis is the number 8 batter. David Malucci on deck. Bowden's pitch is fouled over our heads. Hits the trees and falls just to Matt's left.
I'm going to get one yet.
You had to bring the net, Matt. You should have brought the net.
I was talking to someone earlier who saw what happened in the first game when we were almost hit by a foul ball, and they said, well, I've got a glove in the car. I said, how about a screen?
Yeah. Artie Lape was here. He's going to give me a mask. Change up, and out in front of it is Pillis. One away. And it was the first man who went out last inning when the damage began, and Livingston wound up with 5.
Yeah, it started so innocently. Ground out by Malucci. Then a ground ball on the near second base by Newbart that Diamond got to, but then threw away, and then the floodgates opened.
Yeah. Malucci, the number 9 batter. Yeah, that was a big play. Newbart grounded to second, wide to second. Diamond backhanded it and threw it away. And he made the play perfectly, looking at 2 outs, nobody on, and a whole different situation. Baseball is a game of what-ifs. Outside.
Hodgson continues to throw in the Glenridge bullpen under the supervision of Vinny Byron.
Yeah, Bowden has now thrown a lot of pitches. There's Hodgson. Outside.
Mike Boyette is not available to pitch today.
Yeah, he's used up his innings.
Yeah, he's used up his innings for the week. I'm sure we'll see him on the mound Tuesday in the sectional semifinals.
3-0 pitch. There's a strike. If you saw our Glenridge-Verona game earlier in the week, you remember the last inning, Mike Ostella, the freshman, pitched his first varsity inning.
He looked very good.
He came back yesterday in relief and got the win in the state tournament game against New Providence. Grounder on the right side, backhanded nicely by Pete Ostella, takes it himself, 2 away.
Glenridge will play Butler in the state playoffs on Tuesday. We were awfully impressed with Mike Ostella in the game against Verona. Very poised young man.
His
nice
brother.
Play made by his older brother, Pete.
16,
he's got a hustle to the bag, but he makes it in plenty of time to get Malucci.
And with 2 outs, Garrett Newbart is the batter. And we said at the beginning of the game, the key was to keep Newbart off base. Well, Newbart got on base in the third inning, and 5 runs later, it was over. He's 1 for 2. He struck out his first at-bat. The run he scored was his 39th run of the season.
And that's an awful lot.
It's a lot of runs. Hard hit. Big hop to Ciccolini, who stays with it, throws in the dirt. It will skip past Ostella into dead ball area. And this almost looks like a repeat of his last at-bat. Give him credit for the overthrow and get down to second.
Well,
but this would be an error all the way.
Yeah, error all the way. And you see it so often. After a good play with the glove, the ball's thrown away. You've got to set yourself again. Now, Ciccolini stays down on this ball. It stays down all the way. And whoops, it comes up at the last minute. Makes a nice play. And now he's got to concentrate on the throw. But he kind of nonchalantly, you saw he kind of came over with his wrist, broke his wrist.
A little short arm.
And yeah, he's short arm. He's shaking his head. He can't believe it. And he's probably saying to himself, you make a nice play like that in the field and you throw it away.
Made the hard part.
Yeah.
So down at second is Newbart with 2 outs. And here's Meyerhofer. Bryant tripled his last at bat. Walked his first. Oh, he's 1 for 1. This could be trouble in the right field. Dan Rizzo in right field comes in, calls for it, and makes the catch. So a much different inning. No runs, no hits, an error, runner left at the end of 4. The Livingston Lancers lead it 6-1.
We'll be right back.
6-1 is a score you've seen a lot of lately on TV3. And this one, it's Livingston in the Verona slot. They're considered the home team by a flip of the coin. Livingston 6 and Glen Ridge 1. We're into the top of the fifth inning.
Sun back out and the threat of rain has gone away. Thought back in the third inning that we might see some drops, but that threat has passed by. You know, you look at this Livingston team, and it's the first time we've seen them play, and kind of a deceptive squad.
Yeah.
They're not an imposing team physically, not a big team at all. Massler on the mound is not overpowering. And I know Jimmy Garrick's here watching the game somewhere, the Cedar Grove coach, and he's got to hope in a way that there aren't a lot of his players here, because if there are,
that's right,
they can easily look past this club, because they just don't give you a lot of reasons to think that they can beat you. But here they are beating Glen Ridge 6-1.
Sam Delaney will lead off. He has a base hit.
Of course, the record deceptive, too. They were 1-6 at one point. They've won 14 of their last 21.
You know, you and I were talking a game we did last year about pitcher giving a batter an easy collar. You look so hittable,
yeah, yeah,
and you go away 0-4. Livingston gives you the same type of thing as a team.
Yeah, so far they have.
Yeah, we should have beaten them. They weren't that impressive. They just beat you. That's all they have to do.
Yeah. Now they still have a few more innings here. Mm-hmm. Three more at-bats for Glen Ridge.
Glen Ridge came from behind yesterday to beat New Providence in the state tournament. Came up with three runs in the bottom of the seventh to do it. Chop down the third base side, foul. Diving for a Jerry Poto. The game inches, huh, Matt? 2 inches here and an inch there, and it's a whole different ball.
Yeah.
1-2 on Delaney. Delaney batting eighth, but batting over 300. Hodgson, who's batting the ninth spot, batting over 300 as well. 1-2 pitch, changeup. Popped off the first base side, John Sorrentino, right on the line, and there's one out.
Massler continues to keep the Glen Ridge hitters off balance with his assortment of junk.
Two strikeouts and no walks, I believe. Did hit a batter, though. Three strikeouts, two of them in the third inning. Hodgson was one of those strikeouts.
We may see Hodgson pitching before the day's over.
Yeah.
He's warmed up a lot, and Bowden's thrown an awful lot of pitches.
Give me a bat. I want to get up there and try to hit him. He looks so hittable, Massler. But the defense is alert. They know the balls, as Matt mentioned earlier, is going to come to them. They're ready. Strike one.
Yeah, coaches will tell you that, I mean, they're not going to turn away a power pitcher who's striking out 11, 12 a game, but that does tend to put the defense to sleep a little bit.
Looper into short center field. Newbard, who's quick, and he makes the catch. The Livingston defense continues to shine.
Newbard playing a shallow center field, as you'll see a lot of good center fielders doing, but he still had a long way to come for that one. And we'll take a look at it once again. He's not really playing very deep, but the ball is hit to shallow center field. Kept his eye on it all the way.
A sitting down catch.
He's played a nice center field today.
As he has
all year long.
Bart Ciccolini, 0-2. Hit it back to the mound and a strikeout. When Massler comes with the fastball, and there you see his line on the day, it looks quicker than it is because he doesn't use it all that often. Little pop shortstop will have to take it on a hop. Bare hand throw. Well, it's the Livingston defense that is telling the story of this game, and that was David Malucci on that play. Three up, three down. We go to the home fifth, Livingston by five.
$94 million men and women across the country have made volunteering a way of life. How about you? Whether you're in school, working, a homemaker, or retired, the Volunteer Center of Greater Essex County can use your talents in meeting community needs. Share the gift of yourself with others. Become a volunteer today. Call the Volunteer Center of Greater Essex County.
We're back at Doc Geltz Field. Matt Laughlin along with Bill Bromberg, and we move to the bottom half of the fifth inning. You can watch the championship game of the 59th annual GNT Sunday, June 2nd at 9:30 p.m., Thursday, June 6th at 8 o'clock on TV3. We know that Cedar Grove is there. At this point, it looks like Livingston has a date for the championship. The championship game will be waged on June 1st at 2 o'clock right here at Doc Geltz Field. This tournament this year, Bill, has left the seeding committee scratching his head because the top four teams have been eliminated. Cedar Grove, the fifth-seeded team, the highest-seeded team alive. If Livingston holds on to this lead, they will have come out of having to play a preliminary game beating West Orange before they moved into the first round of the GNT. They kind of came out of nowhere. Of course, understandable that with their bad start, that their record at the time of the seeding did not justify them being moved up higher. But they have certainly played well as of late, and they're on the verge of moving into the championship game.
Parity has hit Essex County. Very well-balanced county. No team really heads and shoulders above anyone else, as proven by this tournament. Sorrentino, Conforti, and Sonnenborg for Livingston. Sorrentino is 0 for 1. He struck out and then was hit by a pitch, scored a run. Jim Bowden has gone back to the mound. Swing and a miss.
Livingston made the final in 1989.
First year coach, John Schmidt. First year head coach. He's been with the Livingston system for many years as either a freshman or JV coach.
14 altogether.
Bill Lampeter, the longtime coach, now retired.
Glen Ridge, by the way, is the team that beat Livingston in that 89 final. Mm-hmm. Lancers have waited 2 years, and they're on the verge of revenge.
Payback. One pitch. Hard down the right field line, but foul. 1-2. If next week it is Livingston and Cedar Grove, Massler against Ehrlich, you'll see two gentlemen, both very tall, but boy, their approach to pitching is so much different.
Mm. Yeah, Ehrlich, a power pitcher.
Swung on and missed.
Boone took a little something off of that one. And Sorrentino, a strikeout victim for the second time.
Right fielder number
John
31,
Conforti,
John Conforti.
Fifth strikeout of the ball game for Bowden. Slow breaking pitch that Sorrentino's out in front.
Conforti has grounded to third and walked. Has scored a run. Pop up on the right side. Chris Diamond. Two out.
Livingston's not thinking in terms of scoring anymore. They'll take runs.
Oh, yeah.
Don't get me wrong. They're not going to just go up there and swing at anything. But scoring runs at this point is not what they're going to be concerned with. It's now just going out for two more innings, holding Glen Ridge.
Number 33.
Game is official.
I don't think we have to worry about it.
Andy Sonnenberg, the designated hitter, looked at a third strike and popped the third. He's 0 for 2. Strike one.
Rich Kennedy warming up, a freshman in the Glen Ridge bullpen. His older brothers, Bill and Dave, played for this team. He's the youngest son of Bill Kennedy. Fine sports writer, now works down for one of the Trenton newspapers as an editor.
Kennedy was,
I think it's
called up.
Is it handball or squash? One of those two. Bill is like a nationally ranked, Bill Sr. is like a nationally ranked player.
Foul back, watch out. You stay alert here at Doc Geltz. Those foul balls come flying back into the stands.
Well, there's a wide screen behind home plate, as you can see on our center field shot, but there's a lot of open space also.
Pitch to Sonnenberg, takes a little bit off, it's outside. 2-2. Hit towards shortstop King. He's over to Stella. And three up, three down for the Lancers in the fifth inning. We're getting to the home stretch. Will it be Livingston? We'll find out. They lead 6-1.
Downtown, A Talk with Your Mayor is a program on Suburban Cable Vision TV 3, which allows mayors the opportunity to address issues of concern affecting their municipalities. Whether it's an hour-long live call-in show with host Rich Leonard or a half-hour tape program, the series provides an open forum for mayors to share with viewers the ideas and policies regarding issues of local and regional interest. Don't miss Downtown, only on Suburban Cable Vision TV 3.
Byron Brothers, a little strategy session, man.
Well, there's, you know, they can talk an awful lot, but there's not a whole heck of a lot they can do about it anymore. It's up to their team, and Masler has just done a masterful job of keeping these potent Glenridge bats from hurting them.
Well, if they do make the comeback, the guy is going to tell you about it, my partner Matt Lachlan.
And at this point, Bill, it doesn't look as if there's going to be much of a comeback from Glenridge. You learn never to say never in this game, but Masler has done a very fine job. Top half of the sixth inning, he's just six outs away from pitching his team into the championship game. It would be his fourth win of the season against two defeats. He has struck out three. He has not walked a batter, and that not really surprising as we take a look at his strikes to balls ratio. 57 pitches, and most of them have been four strikes. Again, the three strikeouts, no walks, really not a surprise. In 47 innings coming into the game, he had struck out 42 and walked just nine. Dan Rizzo, Chris Diamond, Jeff Giambrone scheduled to face Masler here in the sixth inning. Glenridge has been limited to just three hits. They scored in the second inning, but that's been it. Rizzo bunts it up in the air. Easy play by Pillis. Sixth consecutive batter retired by Masler. So one down here in the sixth inning, and Chris Diamond comes to the plate. He has flied out and struck out. Masler has allowed just four base runners. A single by Mike Boyette to short in the second. Ostella, the next batter up, was hit by a pitch. There were runners at first and second. Delaney had a base hit. And that brought in the run as Boyette continued home. What happened was there's a ground ball to short as Diamond flies out. Ground ball to short, and the ball was flipped to second trying to force Ostella. Ostella beat the throw, and Boyette never stopped running, going from second to third, just kept coming home. That's how he scored. That's how they scored their run. The only other base runner came in the fourth inning when Tom King got on an infield hit. Two down here, and Jeff Giambrone, who has hit the ball hard twice. Both times, Garrett Newbart was on the receiving end. The first time a fine running grab in the gap by Newbart. The second time a line drive drilled right at him in center field. A hard 0-for-2 for Giambrone. Giambrone, a junior, will return next year, as will Tom King, Sam Delaney, and Tyler Hodgson from the starting lineup today. The others are seniors. A lot of players returned for Glen Ridge from last year's club. No reason to think they wouldn't experience success this year. Right now they're 16-5-1 and in the semifinals of the North 2 Group 1 Championships.
Now those two freshman pitchers for next year, Matt.
Mm-hmm. 2-1 the count to GM Brown. Tom King awaits his turn on deck. Josh Masler has been in control all day.
And that's literally true. Control has been the key for him.
Mm-hmm. With his pitching, it has to be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He doesn't have the tools to overpower a team, so he better have good control.
Some of our best pitched games that we've seen on TV3 this year have been by pitchers who are not overpowering.
Two two to GM Brown. Time running out on the Ridgers. Down to their final four outs. As Bobby Pillis wants to talk things over with Masler. We hope that you'll be able to join us for the championship game of the 59th annual GNT. Even more so, we hope that you can come out and see it in person Saturday afternoon at 2 o'clock here at Doc Geltz Field. We will show it to you Sunday evening at 9:30 and again Thursday the 6th on TV3. GM Brown fouls it off to stay alive at 2-2.
Only have 1-3 ball count. Wow.
Time called by GM Brown as Masler takes a little too much time in his mind. That's a pretty telling statistic.
Yes, it is.
He's been ahead of hitters, kept them off stride, forced them to swing at his pitches. Full count to GM Brown. He went to a 3-2 count to Rizzo back in the third inning. Second time he's gone full in the ball game. And a walk. So GM Brown fouls off a couple of pitches and then is able to work out a walk from Masler.
Shortstop number 5, Tom King.
Streak of 7 consecutive batters retired is broken with that walk. 2 down for Tom King. Tom had an infield single in the fourth inning. Moved to second on a fielder's choice, but was stranded there. He also popped out to short in the second inning. Except for GM Brown's hit balls, there really haven't been too many hard hit balls either, Bill.
No.
Timmy Byron down at third, hoping his team can pull this one out, come from behind. They'll have to do so in a hurry. We're in the top half of the sixth inning. They trail by 5. Had a 1-0 lead after the top half of the second inning, but Livingston came back in the bottom of the second to tie things up, and then in the third put a 5 spot on the board. They lead 6-1. Tom King fans nearby, hoping that King can do something here. I think that's the president and vice president of the fan club that we're standing nearby.
It's a third straight game that we've had. It was 6-1 in which one of the teams had a 5-run inning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 5-run fifth for Cedar Grove propelled them to a 6-1 victory over Eastside in the first semifinal of this tournament. 5-run first inning boosted Carteret to the 6-1 victory in the quarterfinal round of the Central Jersey Group 2 playoffs. And a 5-run third here
for Livingston. Poto has to go down low to field the hop, makes the play across the diamond. And another relatively easy inning for Masler. He just continues to mow them down in easy style. 5.5 innings in the books, and it's a 6-1 Livingston lead.
Suburban Cablevision's TV3 is your local origination channel, serving Suburban's 42 neighboring communities with the best in local coverage of the events that shape the suburban viewing area. From high school sports to local politics, TV3's committed to informing and entertaining you with the best in local programming.
He's partially blocked now. There's three gentlemen there with red shirts on. The gentleman with the sunglasses on and the gray shorts looks different out of a uniform. We're used to seeing him in a Livingston Lancer uniform, former longtime head coach of the Livingston Lancers, Bill Lampeter.
Both former coaches of these two teams here rooting for their former players.
And the gentleman who's looking toward our camera now with his arms folded across his chest, Aaron Greenberg, who is a huge supporter of Livingston Athletics. He calls in the results of all the Livingston football games for our scoreboard show, and geez, you see him at all big Livingston games. Mm-hmm. Never mind big Livingston games, at all Livingston games.
And the other gentleman was Al Morantz, the coach of the girls basketball team.
If anybody asks you, Bill, what I could use for Christmas next year, I say steel-tipped shoes for all the names that I've been dropping
the
last couple of
games. I heard Tony Hope is going to give you a quarter for every name you've dropped today. Tony's going to break into his wallet.
Bottom half of the sixth inning, it'll be Eric Rothfeld, Jerry Poto, and Bobby Pillis scheduled to face Jim Bowden.
That's the best thing about the GNT, because people come out, not necessarily the fans of the teams respectfully, but everybody comes out just for coaches, scouts, former players. Kind of missed that last year. Last year's final was played under the worst possible weather conditions.
Yeah, it was one of those days where the tournament committee was kind of caught between a rock and a hard place. It was a Sunday afternoon start, so did you want to bring everybody back for Monday or postpone it another week? That wasn't really fair. Then once they got it underway and tried to get the game in, Seton Hall threw everybody a curveball because they jumped out to a big lead, and you weren't about to take those runs off the board. They scored 8 runs in the second inning as they batted around, sent 14 batters to the plate, and then the reins kind of opened up, and how do you take an 8-run lead off the board? You can't do it, so you had to wait it out, and they put dry turf down, and finally we got the game in, but it was absolutely abominable conditions. Rothfeld through the hole for a base hit, and he's had a nice day. 3-for-3 mm-hmm. for the sophomore.
Remember that game last year? Coach Shepard kept saying, it's not that bad, the field is playable, and Coach Cohen from Columbia said, come on, this feels terrible. Here's a base hit by Rothfeld in the hole to left. And as Matt said, his third base hit of the game. Very impressive.
Two singles and a triple. And he's hit to all field. Ground ball base hit to left there. He singled to right in the third inning and triple to center in the second. Here's Jerry Poto. Play over.
Rothfeld had that look about him like, I'm getting ready to steal.
He has 4 stolen bases.
Good size lead.
Squaring to bunt. Nice bunt by Poto. Only play for Bowden is to first. And the sacrifice works. Put a runner in scoring position. As I said earlier, Livingston's not worried about scoring runs, but they're not just going to go up there and 1-2-3 it. If they get a chance to build something and put a little more pressure on Glen Ridge, why not?
Catcher, number 23, Bob Pillis. Number 23.
So with one down, Bobby Pillis steps to the plate. He's played a nice game behind the plate. The senior catcher, he's 0-for-2. As we look at John Schmidt down the third base box. Pillis struck out swinging his last time up. And a breaking pitch on the corner.
Matt, if it turns out to be Cedar Grove and Livingston, two very similar teams. Teams that like to bunt. teams that like to put the pressure on you and two teams that don't beat themselves too often. It could be a real interesting ball game.
The field has been bathed in sunshine for most of the day. Back in the third inning, a bit of a cloud cover blew up and things got gray for a while. Well, the sun has come back out in the last couple of innings. Breaking pitch hit him. And so though the runner from second, Rothfeld, moved down to third, he's got to go back. First and second now with one down. Second hit batter by Bowden. He hit Sorrentino back in the third inning.
First up, number 28, Dan Marucci.
May have a pinch runner for Pillis.
David Alfano, a junior reserve outfielder, comes in to run. He's been on a tear with the bat lately, five for his last five. Up until that point, he had been 0 for 9.
Ooh.
So he goes from a batting average of 0-0-0 to an average of 4.29. He's out there to give the catcher a break so that Pillis can come back in and stay out of the sunshine and rest up for the seventh inning. Rothfeld down at second base and Alfano on at first. Malucci offered for a second and pulled it back, but it was a call strike. Malucci 0 for 2 today. Grounded out twice, once to second, once to first. Again, had thoughts, pulled the bat back, and it was on the outside corner for strike two. Malucci in a hole, 0-2. On deck, Garrett Newbart. Call strike three. No advance possible by the batter as first base is occupied. The runners don't move up.
Yeah, with less than two out, if first base is occupied, you cannot run. The pitch is in for a call, strike three. Off the tip of the glove of Giambrone. Malucci started to run, then realized he couldn't.
Sixth strikeout for Bowden. And here's the top of the order in Garrett Newbart. Newbart struck out his first time up. Singled and scored in the third. Reached on an error in the fourth. He's 1 for 3. Played a fine game defensively in center field. He's got outstanding numbers. We talked about him earlier, 28 for 28 in stolen bases. Has scored 39 runs this year.
He's the ideal leadoff batter.
He's got a good number two man behind him in Meyerhofer, who awaits his turn on deck. A gapper. I don't know if anybody will catch up with it. Yes, Stan Rizzo tracks it down. The ball was hit high enough for Rizzo to move over into the gap and haul it in. That'll do it in the sixth inning for the Lancers. No runs, a hit, no errors, and two left on. After six full innings of play, it's Glen Ridge trailing by 5-6-1.
Hi, I'm Merlin Olson of the Children's Miracle Network, and I'm here with Molly Barber and our friend Mickey Mouse, who is about to unveil a most effective piece of medical equipment, a device with the ability to save the lives of thousands of children.
Please put yours to good use by calling in your pledge during the Children's Miracle Network telethon, live from Disneyland, to benefit children at Children's Specialized Hospital and Children's Hospital of New Jersey, right here on Suburban Cable Vision TV 3, June 1st and 2nd.
That young man has been masterful today. Six innings,
Struck out three, walked one, has given up just three hits. And most importantly, he has kept Glenn Ridge off stride, off balance all day.
And that was the story we had gotten before the game ever started, and it's lived up to its billing.
He throws his off-speed pitches for strikes, and he makes you hit his pitches. And he relies on the defense behind them, and they have played error-free baseball behind him. Here in the seventh inning, Mike Boyette, Pete Ostella, and Sam Delaney, the first three hitters scheduled to face Josh Masler.
Masler only has three victories on the season, but I believe two of them have been in the GNT and may increase that number by one each in about another 5 or 10 minutes.
Infield and the battery get together. I don't know, Bill, if after the Union game when Livingston lost by a score of 13-5 to fall to 1-6, if this team would have thought about the possibility of being in the Greater Newark Tournament Championship game. They were finding an identity, trying to make some corrections on the defense. Then it all came together, and they're on the verge of moving to Saturday's championship game. Boyette, 1-for-2, singled and scored the only Glenn Ridge run back in the second inning.
At the seating committee meeting, I think at that point, with all the rain we had in April, Livingston came into the meeting something like 4-7.
An example of what Masler has done all day. Took an awful lot off that pitch, and Boyette just waving at it.
Just watch the picture. No comment needed.
And Masler jumps out ahead 0-2.
That even brought a smile to his face. Something about this first base dugout. I know it seems like every year it's that first base dugout.
Yeah, the team that occupies that dugout seems to have more than the normal share of success.
Sure does.
Popped up, should be an easy play. Poto calling for it at third. One down. Glenn Ridge down to its final two outs. Their season will continue as they will take on Butler in the sectional semifinals on Tuesday. Butler knocked off top-seeded Brearley yesterday by a score of 5-4. Glenn Ridge defeated New Providence, the defending sectional champion, by a score of 6-5. So the season will continue for Glenn Ridge. For Livingston, every game could be their last. They did not qualify for the state playoffs. They have marched through this tournament undefeated, and they are on the verge of moving to the championship round. Two down. And even for a good-hitting team like Glenn Ridge, a five-run, two-out rally is hardly likely.
He's retired 15 of the last 17 men he's faced.
Delaney has one of the three hits given up by Masler. Masler has allowed just one runner to reach third. That was Boyette, who scored. One walk, three strikeouts for the senior right-hander. Delaney had an infield hit in the second inning, and on that play, Boyette scored all the way from second base. And Delaney popped out to first baseman John Sorrentino. 1-1. Nice, easy, fluid motion by Masler. Doesn't try to overpower anyone. People talk about staying within yourself. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if there's a real easy explanation of it, but watch Masler throw, and that's an example of someone staying within himself. Should be the ball game. Newbar coming in, and the Livingston Lancers advance to the GNT Championship as they continue their hot roll in the 59th annual GNT. Today, they defeat Glenn Ridge by a score of 6-1 as they knock off yet another seeded club And on Saturday afternoon at 2 o'clock, they will face Cedar Grove for the 59th annual GNT Crown. We'll come back to wrap up this game right after this.
You know, we've been really lucky. Good health, good jobs, great family. Wouldn't it be nice to do something for others who haven't been as lucky?
So how's the chance to try and save someone's life sound to you?
This is an organ donor card. Sign it and you could save someone's life. The card and family consent allow doctors to give your organs and tissues to others upon your death, and only after every effort has been made to sustain life. You could help a blind person see, end dialysis for a kidney patient, even give life to a person with a bad heart. Call 1-800-541-0075 today for more information.
It's nice to know with this we could give someone a new life.
Livingston continues its march through the GNT. They win this afternoon by a score of 6-1. They will play in Saturday's championship game against Cedar Grove. We have with us Eric Rothfeld and winning pitcher Josh Masler and also the head coach John Schmidt. First, Eric, congratulations on your performance. Three hits today has to feel awfully good.
Yeah, it does. I was just trying to hit the ball hard up there, and luckily I was able to get it in there.
This team is on a great run. Did you imagine early in the year that you would be in this position, and what has happened to get you into this position?
No, we started out slow, but as we've been playing, especially in the tournament, you could see the team's been playing much better. And I think, you know, we're a real good shot in the final next week.
Well, whatever plans you had or the team had, you'll have to cancel them because you've got a reservation for 2 o'clock Saturday afternoon. Congratulations on your performance today, and we wish you the best of luck in that game. Eric Rothfeld, now stepping in the winning pitcher, Josh Masler. And Josh, we said that it's hard to define staying within yourself. You hear that term in athletics a lot, but you personified it. You're not going to go out there trying to overpower anybody, but you rely on your defense, you keep the players off balance, and you come away with the victory.
Yeah, well, basically, if I just hit my spots, keep the ball low, it seems to work out well. My defense played exceptional, and that's what the key was today.
This Glen Ridge team comes in with the hot bats. They're a top-seeded club, but I guess at this point, Livingston's afraid of nobody.
Basically, that's true. I don't know, I guess next week's going to be real tough. They swing the bat well. I hope we swing the bat as well as we did today and play good defense. That's what the key is again.
All right, you got here a little late, so you didn't get a chance to see Cedar Grove, but had you heard anything during the course of the tournament about what you might expect from them?
Well, I know they have a good thrower, and he does throw strikes, so if we have a good eye, we should do all right.
Well, Josh, we congratulate you on your performance today. We wish you the best of luck on Saturday in the GNT final. The winning pitcher and now the winning head coach. And John, you've been involved with this Livingston program for a long time on the JV and freshman level. Now you're the head coach, and it feels pretty good in your first year, I imagine, to be in the GNT final.
It's very exciting, especially for the kids, because I had these boys 2 years ago, the seniors, I had them 2 years ago on the JV team. And they've really worked hard last year on a varsity level and this year again, and I really couldn't ask for anything more. It's a great job.
You know, we talked during the course of the game about some of the youngsters, but as you were pointing out before the game, in the case of Eric, he's played all the games. He's not young anymore. He's used to the varsity. And some of the youngsters you inserted at second and short, they've been playing since the seventh game of the year. So you really can't say that it's a young team necessarily, but you do have a lot of underclassmen.
Absolutely. Three out of the four infielders are underclassmen, and they were somewhat experienced, but they're really playing like veterans now. They feel very comfortable, and it's a great time of the year for us. I would hope that next Saturday would be that way, too.
All right, what's going to happen between now and Saturday? What are you going to do with the team?
Well, unfortunately, we, because of the state cap on the number of games, we can't add any games, and we have an open schedule this week. So we're going to try to get together tomorrow night to watch the game on TV. Monday, we're going to have an optional practice, and then Tuesday and Thursday, we're going to try to get together for some inter-squad. Of course, we'll have regular practices Wednesday and Friday.
Well, we know you'll enjoy the replay of this game on TV3. Congratulations on the performance. We look forward to seeing you in the final on Saturday.
Thank you very much.
John Schmidt, the head coach of the Livingston Lancers. And I'm sure, Bill, when he drove home after that sixth loss of the season, they were 1-6, kicked the ball around some more. There is no way he thought about this far down the line. But as he put some of those youngsters in, as the defense solidified, as some bats came around, hey, anything can happen.
Oh, it's proven today.
You almost wonder if destiny isn't riding on the shoulders of the Livingston Lancers, which could be a tough opponent for Cedar Grove next week. It should be a great game, though.
It'll be a study in contrast of the pitchers. A hard thrower, Ron Ulrich, for Cedar Grove. He throws peas. He's 6'5". Massler's a big kid, but he throws off-speed pitches, keeps you off balance. He did so today against Glen Ridge as he pitches Livingston to the victory over the Glen Ridge Ridgers. The final score, once again, 6-1. That'll wrap up our coverage of this semifinal game of the GNT. For Bill Bromberg, I'm Matt Laughlin. Thank you very much for joining us, and have a good night.
On Suburban Cablevision TV3. Whether it's the reading of poetry, the interpretation of dance, or the performance of music, TV3 brings it all to life. From classical to rock. From jazz to ballet, TV3 is committed to bringing you the finest in the performing arts into your living room.
Anymore. What happened, I guess, is the guy said to the girl, you know, you could either stay and sleep with me or my uncle will drive you home. Bill Parcells is gone. He's gone, folks. He's gone. Don't feel bad. They offered him to manage the Yankees. He said he knew nothing about baseball. They said you're perfect for the job. The Queen's here. Did you hear the Queen? Did you know that the Queen brings her own toilet seat when she comes to America? This is true. This is true. There's a new meaning to sitting on the throne in America. All right. All right. Listen, it's time for the Jeopardy jokes, folks. The Jeopardy jokes. And as always, the punchlines come first. A little segment that we started a few weeks ago. I think you're going to like it. How? What did the Indian say to the mermaid? Wait a minute, hold on, don't judge. Crabs on your organ. What's worse than lobsters on your piano? Finding a place to keep it. Finding a place to keep it. What's the worst thing about a leopard giving you the finger? Oh, you laugh, then you moan. Is that the deal here? The only one who got it was Wisconsin, I can't believe. A suppository. A suppository. What do you call a Greek with no arms and no legs? They blow too many assignments. Why do hookers make such poor detectives? There you go. There you go. Ready?